Okay, so let me start by, first of all, by thanking the organizers for organizing this wonderful series of seminars. That I have to say that I'm really enjoying them, so I'm following them every week. I'm really happy to be here to present my work. So in this case, I'm going to talk about this supersymmetric AdS4 for orientifold vacua. That is based on this paper with Fernando Marchesano, with Don Palti, and Alessandro Tomasiello. So let's start. So let me first organize this talk. So what I plan is to divide the talk more or less in two parts. So there will be this first part that will be like more general, like to present all the results, to motivate why this problem is important and all that stuff. And then in this second part, in these 2 and 3 points and the conclusions, I will present like the technical details. I will show the solution, the approximation we are doing. And I would like to do it very pedagogically, since I know that it is quite technical, this problem. Okay, so let's just start. So, as you know, string theory supports many AdS vacua, and with this I mean solutions of the form AdS something, AdSD, cross some internal manifold. For almost all of these vacua, there is one property that the radius of the AdS, of the external manifold, is as big as the radius of the internal manifold. So there's a lot of literature with these examples. So this, from the mathematical point of view, is absolutely okay. I mean, there is no any inconsistency with this point, but from the physical point of view, or from the phenomenologically point of view, this is not good news, no? Because in the end, if we have that the radius of the internal manifold is as big as the radius of the external manifold, we cannot have a really force effective theory. So this is bad for us as physicists. So based on all these examples, last year it was published this AdS design conjecture that, as you know, what it states is that if you try to do this cosmological constant very small, then there is an infinite tower of states whose mass goes like this with the cosmological constant to some power. And in the case of the supersymmetric AdS vacua, this is the case in which we are interested, this power is 1/2. So this is the strong AdS design conjecture. And usually this is because the tower of infinite states is usually the Clausthalean scale. What this conjecture is telling us is that, I mean, it can be shown starting from this, very easy, that the radius of the Clausthalean and the radius of the AdS have to be the same order. In other words, that there cannot be a scale separation. Okay? But it's important to point out that this behavior, it's true for almost of the examples known in the literature. This almost is very important. It will be the key on this game, no? Because, as you know, there are these DGKT vacua that I will refer always to this kind of vacua as DGKT because of these people which published originally the work. Also, I think 1 or 2 months later, after this paper, there was also this paper that is very close. I mean, they're very related. So there is this DGKT vacua. Now, this is just to take T2A to compactify it in a Calabi-Yau orientifold with fluxes turn on. And one can show that in this framework, the radius of the Clausthalean is different from the radius of the AdS. So in other words, there is scale separation in these examples. So, okay, this seems a counterexample to the strong AdS conjecture, no? So one can ask, okay, where is the trick, no? On this vacua? So the point is that the way in which these vacua are derived is working directly with the force defective field theory. So in other words, one is not solving the 10D equations of motion when working with this vacua. And there are some difficulties to the uplift because of the O-planes, that there are intersecting O-planes, and this is quite difficult to solve the equations. So I can already tell you the conclusion of this work is that we have found an approximate solution to the uplift problem. And with approximate, what I mean is that it's a first order in an expansion parameter. This expansion parameter and this first order, I will show you later on what this means. So let me also point out that there was creative work with this. There was Jangans, I think 2 weeks after our paper, that it's very close to what we are doing. I will also point out some later on where the approach are similar. And there's also this Bratti Calderon Menino Uranga paper. What they are proposing is a refinement of the ADX and conjecture in order to accommodate for this K-separation, for this kind of vacua. Okay, so as I was saying, there are like two complementary approaches to this vacua. No? So on the one hand, this is the 4D description, so in which one just take a type 2A, compactifying a Calabi-Yau orientifold with some BEV to the Ramon-Ramon and NSS forms. One plays with the potential that is generated in the 4D field theory, minimize it in a supersymmetric way, in both blank identities, and one gets this DGKT vacua. But in this work, we are interested in the 10D descriptions of this framework. So in other words, we want solutions, a solution of the equations of motion in 10D with this kind of metric, with this metric, so with a four-dimensional ABS. And it's important to point out that in order to have SUSY preserved in 4D, there are some constraints on the internal manifold. So first of all, the internal manifold has to be either a manifold with SU3 or SU3 cross SU3 structure. This one derived in this paper. And also it will be important, so I will not show it, that the 10D equations of motion in the supersymmetric case, they are equivalent to solve the, to put to zero the vanishing, so to have the supersymmetric variations, the fermionic supersymmetric variations, to put them to zero, plus solving the Bianchi identity. So there is, on the left hand side, there is a second order equation, and in the other hand, we have two sets of equations, but they are just first order. So this is why this is important. Okay, so the first question one should ask is, okay, which one of these possible structures correspond to the DGKT? So how is the internal manifold that can accommodate the DGKT vacua? So a key characteristic of this family of vacua is that the G6 is zero. So the integral of this field strength is zero. Or if you are used to the language of Erraiz, Ibañez, Marchesano, and Zoccarato, this is equivalent to have zero zero equal to zero. So this is, of course, this is a 4D property, no? Because this is an integrated equation. But the point is that it restricts the possible 10D uplifts. So one can show that an internal manifold with just an SU3 structure is not rich enough to accommodate this property. So one has to work with an SU3 manifold. And even inside of this branch, this apparently trivial property puts also some technical constraints that I will not discuss. Okay, so let me just recap all these ideas, because this is like the, as I was saying in the introduction, this is like the general part, so I don't want you to lose. So we started here with 4D DGKT, and we have shown, or I have argued, that in order to have supersymmetric in 4D, the internal manifold has to satisfy some properties, and also that because of DGKT have this vanishing G6, this selects one of the allowed internal geometries. So we started here and we arrived here. So we are now here. We know how is the 10D uplift, which kind of internal manifold we have to deal with. So we are happy at this point. And also what I said is that in order to solve the 10D equation of motion is equivalent to solve the supersymmetry equation plus the Bianchi identities. Okay, so this is good. So let me also say that these supersymmetry variations were already solved in 2012 by this paper, Basaraco and Tomasello. This is even more good news. So what we have to do is we have to take these SUSY equations that I said are already solved. We have to make them compatible with the Bianchi identities in order to solve the problem. So having said like all the general framework, we are ready to deal with the equations and to finally to do work, no? And to stop doing just blah blah. So as I said, we are working in the large volume approximation. So let me explain what this means. So inspired by this same paper, the 2012. We will solve the equations in the limit in which the cohomological constant is very small, or equivalently, the string coupling is also very small, and the radius on the internal manifold is very big, so in this limit. Why or how is this motivated? So the point is that if the source is smeared, so if one takes the delta function that it's a localized source and replace it by some function in the same cohomology class, but that is not localized, it's like a general function. So one can show that the smearing solution, the smeared solution, has the following scaling. See, with this parameter n, that it's related with the for flux, so it's not constrained by the tuple equation. So in other words, this n can be as big as one once. So one can have one can be in a parametric control in a regime. So this is the scaling one has on the with the meeting solution. So the point is that one can interpret this scaling as the zeroth order of an expansion of the full solution. So this is what we are doing, and this is what I mean by this large volume approximation and by the order of approximation. Let me also point out that this is exactly the, well, not exactly, but this is the same approach that Jungans follows in his paper. So he's working just with the 4D equation, and we are working from the 10D point of view, but the approach is this, is to expand the full solution motivated by this scaling in this meeting. And as I was saying, what we are going to do is we will expand the solution to the supersymmetric equations that I told you that they were formally solved in 2012 in terms of GS. So instead of working with this N, we will just use GS as the expansion parameter. Okay, so let me explain what lies behind this expansion in order to understand what is happening, because all these things are quite abstract. So the point is that a manifold with just an SU3 structure will be enough if it was not for the Bianchi identity for D2. And the problem is that this Bianchi identity for D2 fails because this setup has a constant dilaton and a constant war factor. This comes from the Bianchi identity for the D0. So the idea is, okay, let us take the SU3 case. Let's extract the underlying SU3 and let's use some of the extra pieces we have in this more general setup to solve the problem we had for just SU3. So this is the leading order of the expansion we are doing, and this is the solution we are obtaining. So for example, in our solution, or in this leading order, so the dilaton and the war factor are no longer constant. They are corrected. So again, coming back to the picture that I was showing you, we started here. Then we went here to the 10D uplift, and I told you that the 10D equations of motion we are interested in solving are equivalent to the Bianchi identities and the supersymmetry equation. This equation, we are expanding them in terms of the GS. At zero order, we recover the smearing, this is good. And at first order, this is the order in which we will be interested. Because with this, we will try to accommodate the Bianchi identities. So we are now, so we started here, we arrived here. This is where we are now. So the point is, okay, let's move to the other side, to the Bianchi identities, and let us try to solve them for the DGKT case. And finally, let's try to make these two equations compatible. Okay, so we are now here. Let us talk about these Bianchi identities. So forget for the moment the supersymmetry equation. So let us focus just on these Bianchi identities. So the point is, okay, let us solve the Bianchi identities for the DGKT. And then, as I was saying, we will use the expansion for the supersymmetry equations to accommodate the result. So consider this H, that this is the H one has in the DGKT case. So the Bianchi identity for this for the two-form flux is this one, which is just the strict derivative, and this is the term coming from the orientifold planes. So a formal solution for these equations can be written like this. So this is just a solution for the Bianchi identity with this H and with this source. And the rest of Bianchi identities follows from the solution. So with this, we have solved all the Bianchi identities. So okay, the point is that this H is just an approximation of the actual H. So in other words, this H will correspond to the first order in the expansion we are doing in the supersymmetry equations. So let me show what I'm saying. So the strategy is, okay, let us express the terms of the expansion in terms of quantities solving the Bianchi identities. So for example, I will just show you one example because in order to understand this. So for the Bianchi identity, I show you that the solution can be written like this. This is the solution for the Bianchi identities. And on the other hand, taking the supersymmetry equations, the solution to this equation, and doing the expansion in GS that I motivated some slides ago, one can show that this F2 can be written like this, okay? With this omega and this J defining an SU3 structure. So the point is just, okay, let's just identify these two quantities. So one just has to identify this J with this J Calabi-Yau plus some corrections, and this thing inside the brackets, inside the parentheses, is identified with this other thing inside the other parentheses. So this is this part. So as you see, the new things come to order at AGS order in order to cancel this order here. And also there is this one that if you put it here, so the stereo derivative of one is zero, so at zero order, this F2 is zero, so this is the smearing. And the first order in the expansion, so at GS order, we recover the Bianchi identity. So we recover the solution for the Bianchi identity for the age of the DGKT. So then one can do the same for the rest of functions, this is what we did. And we did a split toroid example. If you're interested, you can have a look at that. So let me come back to this graph. So again, we started here. I explained to you that the 10D uplift has to be like this. And we showed that there was two equations we were interested in solving. So one of them, we expand them in terms of this GS, and the other one, we solve them. So the Bianchi identity, we solve it for the GKT. So finally, our result is that this first order expansion is compatible with this with the Bianchi identity solved for the DGKT. So this is our result. So finally, I can see that we have reached our destination with this. So this is the final stop in this long path. So let me also show the rest of functions in order to have a taste of what we are doing. So as I was showing you this age, for example, so at zero order, we recover the usual smearing or the usual smeared solution of this paper. So just have a look to the things in red. So this is the DGKT, this is zero at zero order. This is again the DGKT, this is constant, and this J just Calabi-Yau. So this is the smearing solution. At first order, this is our result. There are some corrections appearing with this GS. So, I mean, in this slide, I have just put these ordered things, but these are really explicit functions that we have compute. These are not just ordered things, but true things, if you want. And with this correction, the Bianchi identity solve with this smear H, and the abstraction that was present for the SU3 case is avoided in this solution, at least at the level of approximation we are working. So I think I'm already finishing. It's a little bit soon, okay. So the conclusions of all your work is that first of all, the DGKT has passed a non-trivial first test because there could have been abstraction already at this order. And what we have shown is that at least at first order, things are okay. Of course, abstractions could come at higher orders. On one, if one wants to consider more orders in this GS expansion, of course, then string loop corrections and alpha prime correction play a role, because in the end they will be of the same order correction, so they are also important and they have to be considered. So this is important if one, I mean, the problem gets more complicated if one wants to consider higher orders in this knowledge game. Also, let me say that I think I didn't say it in the talk, but we are just dealing with equations with the two two derivative equations. We are not considering sublime corrections, neither the GS correction. So this is just a two derivative axiom. Also, let me also point out that this expansion breaks down near the orientifold planes, because one can show that, as usual, the correction gets is bigger than the zeroth order when we approach the orientifold planes. So there is still progress to do in understanding these objects. And also, let me also point out that I think I mentioned it in the beginning of this talk, that the problem with the uplift was because of these orientifold planes that were intersecting, and because the equations are really hard to solve. So doing this approximation at the level of expansion we are working, the intersection terms are not present, so they appear at next order in the expansion. That's why the equations are not that easy, but are easy to solve, because these interaction terms are appearing at next order, so at next order in the expansion, yes. So finally, with the result, the conclusion is that we are closer to establish the existence of vacua with scale separation in string theory. This is something that I think it's very important in order to prove that string theory can lead to really four different theories. And I hope that the problem is settled in the not too distant future. So this is all I wanted to say. Thank you for your attention. If you have comments or questions or complaints, whatever.
Great. Thank you, Joanne, for your very nice talk. Are there any questions? Well, while we wait, I think I have one. So I was wondering what sorts of difficulties start arriving at higher orders? Because I would have thought that, just kind of basic intuition, or my basic intuition is that if I can demonstrate a solution at leading order, that I can just continually improve upon that. Are there examples where you can have a solution, an approximate solution at zeroth and first order, and then somehow at second order, it all falls apart? Maybe I should say it slightly differently. Are there indications that at second order, the structure of the equations of motion and the Bianchi identities that you're trying to solve change appreciably?
I don't think so. But the problem, as far as I can see, is that the problem at the next order is that you have to worry about this expansion we are doing in the GS, but the point is that you have also to consider this string loop correction and this alpha prime correction that are competing with the expansion we are doing. So of course the problem gets more and more involving, no? You consider more and more orders in the expansion. So I don't know if the equations can solve that easily in that case. But of course it's something that it's super interesting to show.
Yeah.
But I don't know.
I see. Are there any other questions? Well, if not, let's thank Joanne again for his very nice talk, very pedagogical talk.
Thank you.